Let him expiate the sin, and let the soul go on to peace. So this was part of the Egyptian ritual, because they had to have some of these things themselves. They had to explain life. They also had to explain what happens to their minds when the individual passed on. Where did he go? According to the Egyptian belief, if he was reasonably virtuous, he went into the Elysian fields. He went into the beautiful land of the blessed dead. But the fact that he went there did not necessarily change him, because in the land of the dead, the Nile always overflowed its banks. The crop was always abundant, but the souls of the dead all worked. The death was not a symbol of sitting back somewhere and trying to play a musical instrument. Death was to live in a world as beautiful as Egypt, but ruled by divine law, so that there could be no sin and no crime. And every individual had the right to earn his own way and have the security that he had earned, and nothing and no one could take it from him. So according to what he was, he went on to the fields of the blessed. And there's a story of the banker who, after a day, was an honest banker. He did very well. He passed the examination and went on to the afterlife. But he was a banker, and of course, there's no banking over there. So he did. What was happening was very simple. After all, whether you're a banker or a farmer or anything else is all in yourself. You are what you believe you are. Therefore, this man believed he was a banker. And this, as a result of this believing, he found himself in the other world, seated comfortably at a table with his scales and everything in front of him, making money, changing currency, doing all the services of banking, and going on and enjoying life until it came time for him to come back again into embodiment. As an honest man, he became a happy banker, because that's what he wanted to be. The priest wanted to be a better priest. The philosopher wanted to be a greater philosopher. But each life and each embodiment and each attainment was according to the need and to the acceptances of the person. The more advanced the individual was, the more lofty the afterlife. But where it was very simple, it could still be very beautiful. And the Egyptians figured that the farmer had just as good a heaven and just as much happiness as the greatest priest. Each was in the condition that fulfilled its own needs. And these needs, as they grew and expanded through time, were fulfilled by right conduct. So all this symbolism is found carved on the temple walls, found in the ancient manuscripts and in the records that have descended from scholars who lived in those days. Thus we have all kinds of symbols. We have everything that is necessary to some way make life significant to the person. Today we have a great belief and a great need of believing in integrities that are more important than the mistakes that we make every day. But in the course of time, something has happened that is a little unfortunate, I think, because others may disagree with me. I think it's a misfortune that we have lost this world of fairy tales, this world of symbols, this marvelous, adventurous realm in which virtue does survive and does succeed, and those who live well live happily ever after. This world was part of something that was a deeper believing than we have today, and probably came nearer to believing true than the beliefs that we do cherish in our modern society. There seems to be a lack of the love of beauty, of the recognition of the divine warmth of existence. We have become so interested in laws, so interested in processes, so much concerned with computerizations, that we have forgotten the beauty, the dignity of a universe of gentle, constructive emotions, a universe in which love and friendship and understanding, security, mutual helpfulness were the great ideas and the great ideals. Now, where you had a mystical theology, it was easy to sustain those concepts, even though some, of course, always disobeyed them. But the general group of persons lived hopefully and lived with a full understanding that somewhere in space there was an orderliness which would protect and preserve them. Their belief in God made them sharers in a divinely guided world, a universe of eternal benevolence. As we gradually lost track of this, as the gods seemed to retire to their distant Olympian thrones, and the world was left open to politicians and economists and industrialists, something went wrong. The wonderful overtones were lost and are now generally regarded as superstitions. It is considered now a superstition to believe in the presence of this eternally divine power. And yet, if we look out at life and get a little ways off from our own narrow particulars with which we are concerned, this universe of beauty, this universe of love and friendship, this universe of life does still exist. It is everywhere. Every natural process that makes up the vast pageantry of existence is essentially a beautiful process. It is meritorious. It is gentle. It is kind. And all the mistakes that we make some way get cleared up. We do solve the problems. We do go on. And most persons do dream of life to come and of better conditions than they know now. All of this was a heritage from the past. It was all believed, and people lived according to it. Today, your anthropologist will say that they were very childish, and yet maybe they were childish. But Jesus said of children that of them is the kingdom of God. And the same thought occurs in the writings of Chinese philosophers, especially Mencius and Laozi. The child heart is the thing we have lost. And we've lost with it the fairy tale and the legend. We've lost Hans Christian Andersen and the Brothers Grimm. We have lost a world of fantasy, which unfortunately faded away but has never actually been disproved. That there might be beauty that we don't recognize, that there may be love that we don't know how to experience. These things are there, but we have gradually lost contact with them. I remember Burbank told me one afternoon in Santa Rosa, he said, "You think you've got five senses, and that you're pretty smart because you have them." I'm convinced that he, from my own researches, that animals and plants have more than 20 sensory perceptions, more than we have, but not focused in the same level as ours. They have the worlds of their own, and in those worlds, laws that are beautiful and kind and good are operating. We may not be able to understand them, and our treatment of these various creatures does not show understanding in many instances, but that all forms of life have hope, have some internal power within themselves. Burbank used to talk to his plants, and they did what he wanted them to. They sent students from the universities up to Santa Rosa, and they did everything that Burbank did, but they wouldn't bother to talk to the plants, and theirs died. The only one, apparently, who was ever able to really carry it on successfully was an old Chinese gardener that Burbank had. The Chinese gardener got down on his knees and had heart-to-heart talks with the calla lily, and it did what he wanted it to do. But all the high specialized students with great knowledges of botany and horticulture got nowhere. And the world of make-believe, so-called, is very largely a world of love, a world in which things are more beautiful than we thought they were. A world in which something very warm and very close, very divine, is near us at all times. And our ancient forebears were really almost able to see these things. I remember these in one of the dialogues of Socrates, that he and his disciples gathered in a grove by the side of the road to have scholarly discourse. And Socrates asked the disciples to join him in prayer. to the muses and the nymphs and the hamadryas.